Hail, fellow sword collectors. It's myself, Jonathan, also known as the PC Genie. Now, today we're going to be looking at this. This is the John Barnett circa 1400s Oakshot type 14 type of arming sword, which in this case is called the Archer's Sword. Now, in terms of the price, it is, well, I've checked on a couple of websites, they're going for about £79.95 and basically around about 80 great British pounds. And I've checked from a couple of websites, and actually it's fairly unchanged from around just over six years ago when it was actually obtained for me. Now, I'll divide this review into three parts. We'll have the standard type of torque view, then we'll have some test cutting if you want to see that, and if you're interested, the peculiar circumstances under which I actually obtained this. Anyway, so continuing on with the review. Now, in terms of this sword, it's my first ever sword, so I was very impressed with it at first, but I find it not so great nowadays. Now I've had a lot more experience with other types of weapons. So let's go over why. Now, first off, let's talk about the scabbard. So here it is. This is the scabbard. Please forgive the rust. That's basically my fault. I haven't really been taking care of this that well. Like I say, it was my first ever sword. I didn't really know much about maintenance. So any sort of rust and things like that you see on the sword and on the scabbard and the general wearing, in that sense, that's basically my fault, not the maker's. But as you can see, this is some kind of, I guess, high carbon steel or spring steel or something. Shape, you've got a faux leather scabbard covering, same sort of steel on the top. It's got, from the weight, I can't tell what kind of wood it is because there's leather which starts to cover over going towards the inside. See that black there? But judging by the weight, it's quite light, so I'd say it's some kind of softwood, no idea what exactly. Stitched along the back, as you will see here. So yeah, it's quite nice in terms of the fact that some swords I have purchased, and I have seen other people have, they don't even come with any sheaths or scabbards. You have to go to special custom makers to get them separately, or you do what I do and you can buy something like a belt frog, which just goes on the side of your belt and just holds any sword, and it's not, you know, it's not tailor-made or fits perfectly to that sword, so it'll end up wobbling and being loose. So that's a good point, that it does at least come with a scabbard. Now, in terms of the fitting, it did actually used to fit quite snugly and it was quite good. However, over time, maybe it's from the fact that I've drawn it, even swung it around, even when not using any targets, repeatedly, and then put it back and drawn it out. So you could maybe say it's wear and tear, or you could say maybe it's a fault in design, your choice. But it has led to the fact that when I try to draw it out, I mean, I'll just try to draw it out smoothly now. I don't know if it's easy enough for you to notice, but it has bits where it sort of catches, it has friction, it sticks. And it doesn't matter what sort of angle I'm trying, if I'm trying to pull up or push down or wiggle it around to the sides or, you know, whatever, or even just trying to be, you know, sort of draw it out as straight as possible, it keeps catching and the friction ends up making it slow to draw and put back in the sheath. And, I mean, it is something that, although I say I've had this for a number of years, actually, that was a problem that cropped up very soon. We're talking just a couple of months after I purchased this. So that is quite a negative factor because, you know, if I want to be your fancy knight in shining armour, or I need to draw it out quickly. Perfect timing, thank you, scabbard. That actually caught and gave off friction just as I was trying to draw that out. So, not great. Now, in terms of the sword itself, it is something that was both seeming to be sharp, but also dull. I'll go over why. Now, the point, I'll give you a close-up here. Now, bear in mind, I have accidentally stabbed things and I've dulled it and I've had to resharpen it again. So that is a reasonably sharp point. That was even better when I first got it. It was wickedly sharp. It was excellent. It was the sort of point where I had confidence that I didn't know about the temper and the hardness, how much it would stand up to thrusting at things like, say, mail armour or through a gambeson, But in terms of the actual sharpness of the point, I was very confident in it. Like I say, it's only looking a bit duller now, and still okay, because I have used it and I have dulled it and had to resharpen it a few times, and it's not as good as before. However, the opposite is the case for the actual edge. Now, I'm trying to give you a close-up. This is going to be difficult without cutting myself, but yeah, it's hard to see. But basically, I have made it sharp now. Now, this is using things like a bench grinder and using one of those kitchen knife sharpening tools. I have made it quite sharp, and you'll see the cutting test at its best later on. But when it was out of the box, it was very dull. I know it was so bad that I went to a sort of event that was with my historical European martial arts club. We sort of cut up bottles and things, and normally when we're doing stuff like cutting up bottles on YouTube, one of the first things that people tend to comment is that, oh well, it's not as tough as a person, you know, maybe they're a thick clothing or a gambeson or something like that, that might resist the sword which easily carves through, you know, cartons and plastic bottles. So now think, it wasn't sharp enough to even cut through those. It basically would strike the bottles and then they'd just sort of bounce off, maybe have a slight bit of a cut on the you know, the plastic sleeve that has the branding like Coca-Cola or whatever. That is how dull it was out of the box. It was very blunt. I can't remember if it was quite blunt enough for me to just go, you know, run my hands up and down it without risk of cutting, but I know it was definitely at least close. Not impressed at all with how sharp the actual edge was out of the box. It's generally got a diamond sort of cross section, so if you see here, you've got this sort of ridge. No fullering or anything, so it's not my favourite type of design. Anyone who knows me in swords knows I prefer fullering, but that's personal preference anyway. Now, in terms of the general weight and the heft, it's quite heavy. It weighs 3 pounds. Now, if you're new to sword collecting, a typical arming sword, something like this, would weigh in the range of 2 to 2.5 pounds. Now, you can get swords which are lighter, such as small swords, very nimble, thrusty types of swords, and some swords indeed, like arming swords, you can pull it off by having something heavier that's got more heft than a chop, if you're perhaps equipping someone stronger, or you just want a sword that delivers more in the cut. That is something that can be legitimately done. However, this doesn't pull it off, because although I say it's heavy, you'd imagine it being something that's a heavy chopper, so you could just go BAM! Straight through, you know, a gambeson or through armour. Cause that impact. It is actually very back-weighted. Now, here, sorry, the pommel is loose, I'll go over that in a minute. But, let's see, point of balance, let me just find it. Yeah, it's about here. Now, that's very close to the handle. The reason being, it's not actually, you know, normally you'd have maybe a, you know, a sword that's maybe a bit too large, and you've got it a bit back-weighted, maybe it's on something like a rapier or something, it's designed for the thrust. But this is clearly a cutter, so it should have more forward weighting. The reason I think, well, I pretty much know, is if you look at this quillen, you'll see here, it's got this width, and this length, and this sort of thickness. You'll see it's a very thick quillen. Now, if we compare it to this, this is my Regenier sword, you see it's a bit thin on this angle, it's alright on this angle, and it's got this sort of shape. So by comparison, that's got a much lighter set of quillens. They're sturdy, you know, they can take a good bashing and beating without getting destroyed, unless in exceptional circumstances, which wouldn't even be realistic for a battlefield, frankly. So this is overkill. It's just too heavy. It's back-weighting the sword. And the problem with back-weighted weapons is, although, yeah, you can say it's heavier, so yeah, sure, it'd be like a hammer, you can just go BAM and destroy something. But the truth is, it actually makes it significantly less hefty. To get an idea of it, try holding a hammer upside down and maybe strike something like a pillow or something like that. You'll notice that actually, if you had the stick, the handle, without that weight on the bottom, you'd be hitting it much harder for the same strength as when you have all of that weight underneath. It's the same concept happening here. And to make things worse, we've got a full tang. Now, I actually like full tangs. It's something I would have kept if I redesigned the sword, admittedly. But it does add more weight to the back, nonetheless. Now, a full tang, just quickly, is we have the steel of the sword going through the handle all the way, and you've got these scale bits of wood which are sandwiched in between. So you'll see, hopefully the light will show it well enough, you'll see these rivets. And they basically secure the wooden scales of the handle into the, well, into the steel of the tang. And then they're usually secured with glue as well to make it even more secure. And frankly, I don't think this part is going to come apart for years. It's going to be very durable. Now, another part of the back weighting is the pommel. Now, this is a solid lump. It's probably giving almost an extra pound of weight completely to the bottom of the sword. So again, we've got this problem of back weighting. If I extend a cut out, instead of the heft being in the blade, which I'm chopping with, the heft is here towards the handle. So it'd be great if I want to, you know, knock someone out and go BAM! Give them a good pommel strike to the face. This would be super effective at it. But for actual 98% of sword usage, not very good at all. Now you'll notice you might be thinking, you know, I might be an idiot of a sword, I'm holding it so awkwardly. Let's get on to our next point now. Durability. So, I've said, you know, most of it seems to have held up okay. But when I was doing the test cutting today, I mean, the handle is already, you can hear it rattle, and you probably already heard it before, it was quite loose. But worse still, this happened. So great if you're a Scalagrim watcher and, you know, that channel, and you want to take off the pommel and throw it at a person to end them rightly, ha ha ha. Great for that. You've got a big, hefty, heavy pommel to do that with. But it means that, unfortunately, this is where the sword has failed. It's now come apart. Now, this is the irony. Because this weight is gone, although the sword is technically broken, it actually handles better now, because now it's got more. Let's try it again. Yeah. Cool, actually it's quite forward weighted, so now the point of balance is here. So that should tell you just how much weight was in the pommel. I mean, it's still trying to point forward, so let's wiggle it a bit. Ooh. See, about here. So it's gone from here to here. Just with the pommel alone. It was very heavy, it was a solid weight. You get some pommels that are hollow, specifically so they can be large and be good for stopping the hand from slipping off. And that's why I'm not going to do any hefty cuts anymore, because I'm just worried this is going to fly out of my hands, frankly. If we, you know, ignore that for a minute, the fact that it is liable to slip out of my hand, actually, the general handling, the weight and the feel, is better! So, as a broken sword, it's better than when it was a whole sword. That should start to speak volumes about what I think of the quality of the sword. So yeah, not great. It's now fallen apart. Again, you could maybe say it's my abusing, and you'll see the test I did in a minute, and it gives a general idea of what I've done to the sword that has ended up making it come loose over time, and now completely snapped off. And, best still, I actually captured on camera the moment when the pommel came off. So you can judge for yourself whether I'm being abusive and nasty and just, you know, wailing at this until it snaps and it had no chance in hell, or whether you think I was being reasonable and it actually just came apart for no good reason. That's for you to decide. I won't determine your thoughts on it. But yes, that's my opinion on the sword. So overall, it's not great. Now, I've had other swords like this. Here's a comparison. I've already done a review video on this Regenye sword, but you've got a pommel. I think it might be solid. It's got a reasonable balance. It's a bit close to the handle, as all swords are, but it's further forward than the Archer sword there. So it's the same Oakshot Type 14 design, but it's much more nimble and it's much better. This is £180, and that is £80. So yes, it's more than double the price, but I personally would argue a lot more than double the quality. This is going to keep me happy for many years, and I'll probably never want to buy another blunt sword of that type ever again. because I'm happy with it. I just want a sharp equivalent. Whereas in this case of the Archer sword, pretty much just months after I had it, I wasn't really happy with it and I was starting to notice the flaws in it. So yes, that's enough of me yakking about that now. Let's get to the test cutting, shall we? Good stuff. Yeah. Oh, not what I said. Bit of a cut. Merely exaggerated the same cut, I do believe. Don't see any other cuts along here. So, very clean carve there. I'm surprised actually, I would have expected worse. There's a bit of tearing on it, but pretty good. Stabbed through here on the thrust, and came out here. A bit more tearing here at the back, but pretty clean stab through here. Not bad, all said and done. But, you know, there are better quality swords out there. It's mainly the handling I don't like. It's as if the Lord himself has blessed my sharpening efforts. It's done some very clean cuts. You can hardly, well, I mean, you can see some slight sort of edges, but that's probably from bad performance in my own cut, where I was perhaps moving and wobbling a bit as I was doing the cut, but the actual slices themselves are very clean. So, thank you for sticking around this long. Typically people click off by this point, but yeah, in terms of the story, it's a fascinating one. Because, I mean, this goes back to when I was a kid. So I was a child, I had this silly little wooden sword, it was probably about this big, you know, it's one of those things where, in an adult hand, it's practically just a dagger, that kind of sword. I spray-painted it with silver spray paint to make it look more realistic and drew stuff on it, all kinds of stuff, and I thought, you know, one day I want to have a real sword. And I was kind of, you know, I was being almost manipulative. I'm a Christian, and I thought maybe I can try to manipulate God, see if I can ask for something like a really cool sword. Yeah! So I was starting to go over my head. I wanted it to be like this big, I want to have a bit of a broad blade, and I want it to be something that's got that sort of durable but kind of plain, ugly-ish almost kind of design, and I want this and that and the other. And I remember to this day, you know, what it was I wanted. And there are other things that I didn't determine, like whether it had fullering or not, but I didn't know about those things, so, you know, any of those designs is fair. But within the parameters that I did set, you know, I had a good idea of what sort of sword I wanted, and, you know, one that was heavier and manlier than your normal sword, and all sorts of things like this. So I pretty much just ignored it. This was, you know, many years ago. I was probably 8 or 9 or something at that time. Ignored it. Many years later, I mean, I'd almost completely forgotten about it. I didn't really give any serious thought. I thought I was just being silly, a child. So I'm just there. Never had a sword before. And then 18th birthday comes along. Woohoo! Johnny's 18. He's a man. You know, not just having a beard, but he can now do voting and adult stuff like that. And strangely, my auntie came over. Now, it's unusual, it's not to say that she's bad or anything, it's just that we live many counties apart. I'm in the southwest in Devonshire, which is, you know, it's the southwest of England, and most of my relatives, they visit each other because they're quite close. They're in sort of the Midlands or towards places like Wales, so they can go back and forth all over the place to visit each other, whereas really, tactically, it should be us visiting them, you know, to if we want to go and see them, because otherwise they're making a very special trip just to visit us and no other relatives and ignore all the rest of them. So it's not bad that it's rare they visit, but those are the reasons why. But yet, she visited. And I go, oh, you know, it's nice to see you, thank you for coming over on my 18th birthday. And lo and behold, I see a box, and I go, right, it's a box. And I'm admittedly a bit paranoid, I'm always paranoid, that's me. I'm thinking, you know, it's probably going to be one of those things where someone thinks I want something, I don't. It's like, I think if it was my 15th birthday or something, I've got a trampoline, because I wanted it when I was about 10, and I sort of went, don't want it anymore. Don't really want a trampoline. My garden's not big enough for anymore. So all those things. Not to say I'm unappreciative, but I suppose it was in that case. But yeah, I had this box. And I went, right, that's strange. What's in it? And she says, oh, open it up. So I'm sort of testing this box and kind of lifting, going, it's a bit heavy. So I know there's something. You know, it's not just kind of like some. I don't know, something really lightweight and something unimpressive, and kids like me will know, being, I don't know, maybe it's a man thing, but generally the heavier the gift is, the better the gift is. I'm thinking, this is a really heavy present, so it's probably going to be pretty good. And I open it up, and this kind of rectangular box, kind of like this. I open it up, and you'll probably see it in some of my other videos, but the Scottish bollock dagger was there. It was kind of dark in the box, and I just saw this bollock dagger, and I went, wow! I sort of grabbed it. It's a little eating knife inside. Go, wow, cool, a real dagger. Wow, neat. And she goes, oh, I haven't seen nothing yet. Okay. And I knew, you know, but it's a dagger. That is not the whole waste of box. So I go, okay. Box. Oh, what's this strange thing? Mm-hmm. A sword! But yes, it would be cool, you know. I think I've got a sword. Maybe imagine, haha, I've got a sword in a box. That's good on its own. But the part that really hit me was I sort of, you know, I took the sword out of the sheath. And I was kind of, I was having a look at it and thought, hang on! And, you know, it was broad-bladed. It was heavier than usual sword. It was that sort of plain-looking, nothing too fancy sort of design that I wanted. It, with a full tang and a fairly sturdy handle that's last a bit of a beating, it was a durable design. And it's actually quite short, as far as swords go. Here's a sword that's actually not particularly long. It's just a standard sword. Now, we compare these two together. Let's give you better light. And you'll see there a good couple of inches just between these two. Now, compared to other people's arming swords, it's even shorter still. I've actually had it called the dwarf sword. That's how short it is. So, you know, for a kid, a child, that would have looked like quite a large specimen. But to an adult, it's a dwarf sword. So again, it was weird. It basically perfectly fitted all the parameters I set as a kid. Now, I never told my auntie I wanted a sword. In fact, I mean, all she knew is I kind of like medieval history. I took up archery, so I didn't even take up HEMA. You know, I was using bows and shooting arrows at things a lot, and, you know, doing that sort of thing and collecting armor and things. She knew I liked medieval things, and of course, liking medieval things, I like swords, but she didn't know what sort of sword I liked. I could have wanted a two-handed sword, one-handed sword, maybe a falchion single-edged. That's another thing, I wanted a double-edged sword. Could have wanted a falchion, you know, maybe an arming sword that's longer, a more triangular cross-section. There's so many designs, and it would take too long to go over them, and yet she got that one, that specific one. She went to Scotland and actually apparently met John Barnett himself. Okay. And said she wants a, well, he's an archer, so some kind of bowman type of person sword, I don't know. So he goes based on the recommendations and picks up, I guess he'll probably want this one then. The coincidence is striking. Now, obviously, in the game of chance, even if there's a tiny chance, yes, there is that chance that it's all a big coincidence. But I don't believe in coincidence. I don't believe in, you know, that there's random chance or luck or anything. Things are set to happen, and they happen. Even, yeah, you get the point. So I thought, wow, it's a weird sort of like miracle thing, but what's the point? It's not going to clothe the poor and feed the hungry. What's going on? I suppose it's one of those things. So yeah, I felt quite blessed that day. That's all. I probably waffled a bit now. I hope you enjoyed it, and see you in the next video. Congratulations for watching this far. I want to see how many people watched this far and actually listen to me when I waffle like this. So have your normal comments, maybe saying the good and bad things in my video, and if you include the number 57 at the end of the comment, just on its own, you know, about context, whatever, or, you know, oh, and, I'll know you've watched this far. So yeah. See you later.